Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Yes, Lord, help us to understand your word this morning as Izzy brings it to us. Open our hearts and minds. Allow us to see what you would have for us. And as we are reminded of the so many young men and women serving our country in far-flung places, Father, we pray for protection. We pray for those who are Christians, that they would be allowed to express their faith, that they would show the love to their fellow Marines or Army or sailors, wherever they're at, Lord. And again, we thank you for this beautiful place to come and worship you. Let you be the center of our attention as Izzy brings you us the word this morning. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, if you turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 8, we're coming to the conclusion of a beautiful passage in you know, unfortunately, the only disservice I have is that we have to, our culture is, how do I say this tactfully? We've grown to be used to getting food in the drive-through scene, you know, quick, immediate, get it in 2 minutes or less, or get it free kind of thing. I remember when McDonald's made that their slogan, if we don't get you your food in 2 minutes. When I was a kid, then the meal was free, and we used to pray that they would get bogged down, and we would get their, you know, yeah, we got free fries today, you know, whatever. But unfortunately, it has led to a culture that is like, give me the meat of the message, and give it to me right away, get it quick, you know, like fast food, like spiritual fast food. I didn't grow up in an era where things about God needed to be that fast. And I didn't grow up in an era where eating was that fast. You know, in a Sicilian household, you grow up, you have 5, 6, sometimes 7 course meals. They last for hours. And we call it supper. And you spend time at the table and you talk. And we didn't have digital devices to interrupt us. So we actually learned, my son Daniel says, your generation knows how to have a conversation, you know, like with people. You can look at them in the eye and you can say, oh, you're looking, you know, something troubling you, or you can read each other because you're used to the art of conversation. But this culture that is being, I can't fight it. This is what I'm coming to learn, is I'm going to have to learn to shorten my sermons, shorten the little things we do for YouTube, the words of encouragement. You know, I find that the ones that are like 3 minutes long, they get the most views. And it's because this generation just wants. My wife and I told her, I'm going to start just teaching one Bible verse with one main idea in 1 minute. You know, and I'm like, I got to figure out a name for this for YouTube, you know, just for this generation, you know. And what's that?
Hit the send button.
Yeah, just like hit it. Just like, but I got to just hit the point and just and do that. But, you know, the part we're on today in Romans 8 is the conclusion of this chapter. And we've taken a couple weeks to break it down, you know, how the different portions. Paul is a masterful writer and has that gift of, like, building the idea, like you do when you have a conversation about something that really means something to you. You can cover it in depth and share that. And I like, personally, to glean those really deep things that you get by having that time to think it through and build upon it. And if this is true, then what, but, you know, that leads me to understand the depth. Now, today we're going to talk about the depth, the breadth, the width, the height of something that he ends the chapter with. Anyone read ahead to the end of Romans 8? What we're going to? We're going to be coming to the immenseness of the love of God. How great is it? And he's coming to the point of what can separate us from that love. You know, when you find out how loving of a God we have, how great is God's love toward us? How much did he do for us? The Bible says he didn't withhold even his only begotten son for us. He gave his son. And when we went over last week, if he would give of his son, how much more will he not give us freely all things that we need? You know, once you really understand this character of God that he allows to be revealed to man, his love toward us, and how much grace he has toward us, how much forgiveness, well, then you get to get a little glimpse into what Paul's building up to today. Now, a couple of weeks ago, we covered the passage, and I have to tie, this is the disservice, is that we break it up week by week into portions, but I just got to put this whole meal back into a real meal, okay? Five courses that you can at least enjoy a real supper today for your soul. Because Paul had said something earlier in what I'll call an earlier course of Romans 8. He said this in verse 23. He said, not only this, but we ourselves having the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly, it says, for our adoption as sons, for the redemption of our body. And we went over in detail how someday what Paul writes to the Corinthians, he says, this mortal body, what we dwell in, will be swallowed up by immortality. This corruption by incorruption. We get to upgrade. I mean, this is like super hope of the faith, isn't it, guys? We're trading in these old bodies for a body, it says, not made by human hands, made by God, eternal in the heavens. And you know, that body is described in the Bible. And I don't know about you, but anyone here up for an upgrade? Like, trade in this body for one, no pain, right? No pain. And I am sure when I look in the mirror at myself in that new body, I'm going to say, now that's what I really look like. Because when I look now, I'm like, not really there yet. You know, it's okay, but I'm much better looking, at least in how I feel inside. And I look in the mirror, I'm like, something's wrong here. You know, it's because we're in a fallen body, in this, you know, in this earthly body. But see, you are gifted a spirit what is eternal inside. It's why we don't do death well, because when we talk about death, we're talking about this earthly shell ceasing. But what about our spirit inside? You know that was made to live forever. And God wants to upgrade you from this earthly shell to what he calls, or Paul calls this one, a tent, to what's the analogy? What, a mansion. We're upgrading. Tent, trade in your tent for a mansion made by God. And when you look at yourself in that, and I know some teachers teach the mansion is a real building that Christ went to build, but I think the mansion really, the more, like, to follow the analogy he's using, is that glorified body that he is going to have for you. Your spirit is going to be put into a body made by God, and you'll be going, now this is me, you know, like, yeah. And you know, I've noticed that God doesn't really worry about buildings. You know, when Jesus came to this earth, did he start any building programs? We're going to start off the church, and we need to get a thermometer and put it on the wall. You know, and as people give, we'll pledge and drive the little red piece up and, you know, add tape or whatever they do. And did Jesus do any of that? No. He wasn't really known for putting the emphasis on physical buildings or on the government. Did he attack the government? No. They tested him even. Took him they said, should we pay tax to Caesar? He said, show me a coin. They gave him a coin. He goes, whose inscription is this? And they go, well, that's Caesar. You know, the coin had Caesar's bust on it. He's like, so what was Jesus' answer? Render to Caesar what Caesar's, and render to what? To God what's God's. Look, guys, you're missing the point. I hate to say this, but I don't mind saying it. I only say it because some people are going to get mad at me, and I'm sorry, but suck it up, okay? So many Christians are so tweaked about this election and protesting and doing all this stuff, and I'm like, wait a minute. Jesus, what would he say? Why are you making that a sidetrack? Why not we seek God first? And did he stop being king? No matter who's the president, no matter who's a ruler of any country, Christ is still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the Christians are told to pray for the leaders, no matter who they are. Whether you like the leader or you don't like the leader, I'm sorry. Jesus said, my Father's house is to be a house of what? Complaining about the government? Let's go to church and complain about who's in office. No. You're supposed to go to church and pray for whoever's in office. You guys, we're not even given any slack on this. We're supposed to keep our focus on God. And we're supposed to lift up our leaders to the Lord and keep the main point the main point. You know, if we stick to that, we would do a lot better. The problem is that Christians get sidetracked from the main point. And I want to bring you back to the real. This Romans 8 has such sweet, in-depth courses of food for my soul. And one of the main courses that he has served up so far is that we have a promise that we're going to be redeemed, our bodies redeemed. And we're awaiting this, it says, eagerly as an adoption that will take place. Now, when I think of an adoption taking place, in my mind, I default to Annie. When you remember that little story with the redheaded girl, the curls, and she was in the orphan Annie, and she was wanting to be adopted. And it, to me, I don't know about any of you, but I can't help but watch that show and you know, the hope that that little girl had. You know, like, someday she's going to get, I'm going to get adopted. Like, and her friend's like, no, you're not, you know, you're, you know. And they, some of them were so negative. I mean, I don't know where they cast some of those kids, but they were like, they were pretty good actors, you know. They were like, you know, and really dogging on her dream of being adopted. But I tell you, I submit to you, even as Christians, when we share the hope what we have that we're going to someday be adopted and we're going to receive new bodies by God, that you might have some of those negative folks around, just like she did in the movie. They're like, you're not going to get anywhere. You're not, you know, and they're going to, and they get uptight. They get uptight with you about, you know, your hope. But I got a question for you. Let's just use this as the analogy. If Daddy Warbucks was in the other room visiting with the head person about adopting her, and he knows he's there to adopt her, but she's in the room with all the kids, and she doesn't know he's there. And he's making all the arrangements to bring her home that day. And she's in the other room listening to all the negative, you're never going to get adopted, I'm going to get adopted before you, and so-and-so got adopted, and you're not, you know, you're like the last one that... Because, by the way, today you're going to find out one of the next courses is that there's someone actually acting like the negative people, saying, it won't happen, not going to happen. And let me show you who it is, because you'll pick up on this. This is the next course of the meal. We read this morning, it says that the Lord, what shall we say then? I'm going to pick up where we had to leave off last week, verse 31. What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, then who can be what? Against us. He did not spare his own son, but he delivered him over for us all. And how will he not also freely give us all things? Now he says, who will bring a charge against God's elect? God's the one who justifies us. And who is the one who condemns? Now, if you want to really answer that question, who is the one that is always accusing us, condemning us, pointing the finger? We know this from Revelation, right? Chapter 12. It says in verse 10 that the devil stands before God daily, night and day, going, it says he accuses the brethren. He's going, did you see Izzy? He's a crumb. You know, and he's giving all of his accusations. But I already know what it says in 1 John 2. It says, if any man sins, he has an advocate with the Father. Advocate, a defense attorney. Who's our defense attorney? Jesus. So Jesus stands up, goes, objection, Your Honor. You know, as the devil's bringing his argument to condemn us and pass judgments on us, Jesus stands and goes, objection, Your Honor. He's my defense attorney. And the Father, being the great judge, says, what's your objection? He says, I already paid for that with my blood. And what's he do? Slam down the gavel, spank, you know, overruled, throw it out. And the devil that rascal, he doesn't quit. He just moves on to someone else. Well, then did you see someone else? You know, what about Paul? You know, what, he doesn't give up just because he didn't get that one to stick. It's like he's just hoping if he keeps slinging enough mud, something's going to stick. But when you have Christ for your advocate, it's all paid for. And this is what Paul's trying to make the next course of the meal for you to understand. Your sins have all been covered through the finished work of Christ. Now, is that a good thing for my soul to feed on? Is that good for my mind to mull over that, you know, yeah, Christ, when he hung on the cross, the last words he said, three words, it is what? Finished. When he gave up his spirit, he was saying, I have accomplished all the requirements of the law for that sacrifice that was required. Remember how they had to sacrifice animals to take away sin? But the law was pointing, it says, forward to a perfect sacrifice, what it says that God would have to make to pay for all of our sin. And Christ, when he did that thing, he surrendered his spirit. He said, it is finished. I did it. It's paid. Now, some of us, we've already heard this, man. We had this at another supper, and it was really good. And, you know, I just got news for you. Sometimes spiritual things that you've learned and you revisit them later, it's kind of like going back and having a meal that you really liked. And it was so good, you're like looking for it. We got to go back to that restaurant and order that prime rib again. That was really, you know, none of you have ever done that, right? You go back to the same restaurant, have the same buffet, and go, oh, that was. Have you ever done that on vacation? Have you ever gone back to the same place just to go have that meal? Yeah, because when it's good, it's good. And one of the best things you can do to feed your soul is to be reminded of the greatest supper that for your to feed you inside is to remember the finished work of Christ. Completely finished. Done. Paid for. Don't let the devil beat you down. Because Paul's saying, who can bring a charge against this finished work? He's putting in perspective. Like, there is no one. You can try, but ain't going to stick. Jewish culture, they use a lot of this rhetorical questions to get you to bring out the point, to make you think of the answer. Who can bring a charge if Christ paid it all? Is this food for my spirit? No one. No one. But how many of us feel condemned sometimes as we go through the week? Now, what was verse 1 of Romans 8? Look back. There is therefore now how much condemnation? For those, I'm going back to the first course of the meal. Remember, I told you, this is, I got to put this in perspective. This is a big supper for your soul. The very first course was, there is now, therefore, now, how much condemnation? No, none, zero, no condemnation, period. Yet, how many believers walk around feeling condemned? And how powerful is condemnation? You know, like, how much can it shut us down? If we're really feeling condemned by someone, it can paralyze us. It can just, literally, can it just, like, freeze us in our tracks? We were doing so well, and then that cutting word came, and someone said, you're just no good, or you're never going to change, or you're always that, you know. And they say that mean, condemning thing, and it just, like, inwardly, it's like puts the freeze on us. It just paralyzes. This meal's worth revisiting. This is worth having another helping. Of there is therefore now no condemnation for you in Christ. And there is therefore now no one, let me just add to the next course, that's allowed to accuse you that it can stick because of what Christ has done. And now we're going to come to the last course. This is dessert. Here's the dessert of Romans 8, guys, for your soul. I think you'll really like this one. And then he says, who's the one that condemns? He said, Christ Jesus, verse 34, is he who died, yes, rather, who was raised, who sits at the right hand of God, and who intercedes for us. In other words, they can't make that accusation stick because we got our defense attorney seated where? Right next to the judge. Right hand of the judge. And does he have his ear, you think? I mean, is that like a setup for us to know God is really got it covered through his son? He's telling us, I got your advocate sits right next to the Father in heaven. He's right next to him. I mean, you talk about, like, would we like our attorney to be that tight with a judge? You know, like, in his good graces, where he could bend the judge's ear and say, hey, judge, I already got that covered. Here's my point, you know? And case dismissed. Throw it out. You can't accuse because we got the best attorney. And then he leads to the dessert, verse 35. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Here's the question. Now, if you think I ask questions when I teach, I do, because I learned it from Paul. He does it all the time. Who accuses you? Can it stick? What shall separate us? How do you like this one? What shall separate us from the love of Christ? Is there anything that can actually separate us from the love of Christ? Well, look at this. Paul says, will tribulation do it? Will distress do it? You ever met anyone distressed? That's like stress with this. No, I mean, we got a few folks doing distress real well. Will persecution, will famine, will nakedness, will peril, will the sword? Will any of these things separate us from God's love? The rhetorical answer is absolutely no. No way. That stuff cannot diminish the love of Christ for you. But how many times when we go through distress or we go through peril or we go through hard times and we're like, oh man, I don't know if God even cares anymore. And we need someone to come along and give us a little sandwich from the buffet, slip us a little side meal. Hey, buddy, I just ate at this. Let me tell you, even the leftovers are worth packing up. Here, I made you a little sandwich, and it just take a bite of this. There is nothing that can separate you from the love of Christ. Nothing. Does my soul need to get fed with that truth? How often do you think it would help me to stay well-adjusted? You know how everyone's into staying, you know, healthy or keeping good practices, you know. How about for your overall spiritual well-being? How often should I mean, we tell people take those, what, multivitamins every day? How much do you think my spirit needs to hear every day that there is nothing that I'm going through that will separate me from the love of Christ? I submit to you it's better than any daily multivitamin. In fact, I think it's the best spiritual multivitamin you could take. Is this verse, just read it every day. What shall separate me from the love of Christ? Start off your day. Starting off today, what shall separate me from the love of Christ today? Just let's start off and ponder that. I'm starting off my day. I wonder, will anything separate me? What if we did this every day as Christians? You know, I mean, they want you to take multivitamins to keep you physically well. Would this keep me spiritually well? Like, I'm going to give a prescription. Every day, pick up your Bible, read Romans 8:35. What shall separate you from the love of Christ? Now, I want for my son-in-law, Robbie, out in the field to, and his whole unit and any of our other servicemen that might listen to this to hear, not even where they're deployed, not even the action that they will see, not anything will separate them. Because they need to hear that. You know, I pray that they get, you know, some way access to the internet. That they can, you know, just hear this, even that little snippet, to be reminded. There's nothing. Our soul needs to be fed this truth, I believe, every day. Start off your day. Okay, let me read you the rest. There's only a couple verses to end this chapter. I'm done. What shall separate me from the love of Christ? Any of this stuff? Peril, famine, nakedness, the sword? No, he says, for just as it is written, For your sake, we are being put to death all day long. We are considered, it says, as sheep to be what? You guys know this from the Psalms, right? This is a quote from Psalm 44, verse 22. We're like sheep to the slaughter. Oh, that's encouraging, Paul. We're like a sacrifice, a living sacrifice? What are you, crazy? Wait a minute. Wasn't Jesus sacrificed? I mean, he could have said, I'll live for myself. But if he would have lived for himself, he wouldn't have died for us. Instead, he showed us a great example for life. He said, if you really want to live, you have to first what? Die. Any man that tries to gain his life, he says, shall lose it. But anyone willing to lose his life for Christ's sake will gain his life into eternity. When we take, and now that's really against American culture. I know there's a spiritual pill that some people can't swallow. They'll be like, what? You want me to give up my life for others? Well, if you want to really make it count, yeah. I mean, if you're not willing to live for others and you make it all about living for yourself, you will become a self-centered kind of snobby person to be around. In fact, most of us won't want to be anywhere near you because all you care about is living for yourself. And those are pretty much the most human nature. We spot people like that, and we usually try to duck to the next aisle over in the grocery store or wherever we encounter those kind of folks because they're not nourishing for our being. It's like you go around people that are like that, and it's almost like I call them spiritual vampires. They suck you dry, you know? Everything is to them about them, and just a little while with them, and you're just like, I am sucked out. I mean, they just like they just latched on and sucked out all the juice, you know? I'm dead. Because it's not like how many of you know people that live their lives and bless others as they go through this life's journey? And when you see them coming, how do you feel when you see those folks coming? You're like, oh, glory, thank you, God, for people like this. Isn't it a joy? It's like there's something refreshing. But see, there is nothing to separate you from Christ's love. And there's nothing to stop you from following Christ's example. He gave his life. He said, if you want to be great in my kingdom, learn to be the servant of how many? All. Just serve others. Now, I know some folks are upset about the campaign, but one thing I heard Donald Trump say is that he wanted to make the office not about the bureaucracy serving itself. He wanted to be there to serve the people. And I pray that he actually does that. I know it's ruffling some feathers. There's some guys getting really nervous. Wait a minute. He's like, these people that don't serve others, they shouldn't be in public service. Isn't it called public service? Okay, I thought that meant you served the public. But some of the legislators today, they don't do anything to serve the public. They serve themselves. And Trump isn't a good politician. He doesn't have that politician finesse. That was nice. Someone helped me. Thank you. Finesse. He's not politically correct yet. But he can say you're fired really well. I watched him do this show. And I think it's making some of the folks nervous because he said, I'm going to call out guys that don't do anything. That talk and talk and don't help the people. We got to help the people. Now, I can get behind that attitude because that's a biblical attitude. Christ says help the people. You know, he says, look up. You see those people? Help them. He doesn't say just go like this. That's what Jesus didn't really get into politics, except for the politics of attacking the spiritual leadership that were those, the Pharisees, Sadducees, the spiritual muckamucks that were like this, were better than everyone else. And he said, he even gave stories about like the Good Samaritan. You know, the spiritual guy walks by, the guy's beat up on the side of the road, and he won't stop to help the guy because I've got to get to service now. I've got to tell everyone how to love God. But there's someone right there you could love it in practice. You could have just gone and helped that guy, but no, I don't have time for that. Jesus would rebuke guys like that. You can't live like, you gotta just put this faith rubber meets the road. You got to live it, right? You got to help the ones God puts in front of you. And you don't have to call the pastor and say, "Pastor, there's someone broke down on the side of the road, and I was thinking maybe you should go help him." Where are you calling from? "Oh, I just drove past them." I have a feeling that the reason God gave you that phone and those eyes and the car that's right next to him is so you would stop and help him. I mean, my job is not to do the whole job. My job is to get us all to do the helping that God puts in front of us. And yes, you have to consider that all day long, you're being put to death, like death to yourself. You're like a sheep to be slaughtered. You have to give your life up. If you really want to gain it, guys, you got to be willing to lay it down. Right in the military, you lay down your life for your whole squad. I mean, for your brothers. You look after each other. That's what makes it such a tight unit, is when you know that there are guys that will lay down their lives for you and you lay down your life for them, and you got each other's back. But I got to be honest, I'm not sure. In Christian circles, I feel like a lot of Christians don't have the other Christians back. And I don't mean that to be like I'm trying to stir the horses, but I'm trying to say, hey, we should do better. If the military men can do this, you know, you guys were invited to be part of Christ's army. You're part of Christian, by the way, the name means soldier of Christ. The word, what we take that ending Christian, comes from the Latin to be the soldier of the general, and our general happens to be Christ. We're to follow his example, and he laid down his life and helped people. Well, I get the last little bit of icing now. I'm going to end it with this to put on the top of the cake. Here's our last course, the last tasty little bite. For some of you, it's a chocolate dipped strawberry. You know, you're not into cake, but I've seen you go to the buffet and get those fruits and the little fountain where you drizzle the stuff in. This is for you. He says, in all these things, verse 37, we overwhelmingly conquer through Christ who loved us. In all these things, we get to overwhelmingly conquer. We're going to win the battles, what he's saying. He says, for I am convinced, and some of you already know this verse. This is the sweet, this is pure sugar for my soul. For I am convinced that there is neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor any other created thing that will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. There is nothing that can separate you from Christ's love. Now, how many of you can give an amen? You know that that's true. Amen? There is, well, I don't know about you, but some of you ever gone back for dessert more than once? Nah. Never even ordered again that same old mud pie that you had over at Huggo's? Or I hear people that visit and go, you know, we've come here every year, and every year we make a pilgrimage to Huggo's to get the mud pie. And I listen to them, and they describe it so good, I'm drooling. You know, like right now my gleeper's going off just thinking about their description. And I think, when it's good, it's good. Face it. That's just the way it is. And this is probably the best dessert I could end the sermon with that I know. Is there is absolutely, for your soul, no sweeter thing for you to learn than these two verses at the end of Romans 8. In fact, some of you might have it on a plaque on your refrigerator or somewhere in your house, but if you don't, I would really like to encourage you. Now, I used to tell people, just write it by hand and stick it to your fridge. Or put it on your mirror where you shave, you men, in the morning, you know, where you see it. So you can start off with a sweet thing for your soul every day that says, for I am convinced that none of this stuff, look, I mean, it's pretty broad on the coverage, don't you think? Let me see. Death, life, angels, principalities, things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, right? I mean, he's covering every base you can. will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. How great is that love? Does my soul need that sweet taste every once in a while to be reminded? We're loved. We are loved. In fact, we're loved so much that he's like the Daddy Warbucks of the spiritual world, sitting on the other side of the glass, you know, making the arrangements for our adoption. And we forget. We forget to be like the orphan Annie going, it's okay. I know he's coming. You know, that movie sticks. It resonates with me because she had that unwavering faith that, like, I know it's coming. I almost want to tell Christians, why don't we just do the same thing in our faith? I mean, how many of you knew this message already, that we're destined to be adopted as sons? We're loved so much. See how great, I could, you know, pick one from 1 John. See how great a love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. And such we are. We're his children. You have been chosen to be adopted by God. But some people are in the waiting room going, I don't know if he's coming. And the other ones are going, you're too ugly. They're not going to adopt you anyway. You have curly hair. Or you're you know, whatever. I remember they were mean to that girl. But it didn't change the fact that Daddy Warbucks was coming. And there was nothing going to stop that guy. He had the bucks. He could buy the whole orphanage, you know, and get the girl. I mean, he was not going to let. Remember in the movie how he did? That's the part I loved as a kid. He didn't let anything stand in his way. When he decided it was done, it was done. And that mean person that was in the way through the whole movie that caused the trouble, it was like, flick, you know, gone. Yeah, right? No more. How about the devil who's been causing us all this trouble? What do you think the book says will happen to him at the end? Flick. He's out of the picture. We're talking about, forget Daddy Warbucks. We're talking about God Almighty is the Daddy Warbucks in this story, and we're the orphan Annies, and he's coming to get us. And we just need to remember that. Because our soul needs this food. It makes us well adjusted. It makes us look at this life with a broader perspective. Hey, I'm not going to be here forever. And I'm going to be out of here. You remember how Orphan Annie was like helping the other kids in the orphanage? And even though she's suffering with them, she's like, it's okay, we're getting out. She had that hope. We would do the same, and we would do well to remember this. So we could keep the perspective of, you know, we're not going to be here forever. Why not just use this day and live it the best to help whoever God puts in front of us? Because we're going to be gone soon. And it's not like we're going to be gone off to nothingness, nirvana, into an endless blip of nothing. No, we're going to be home. We're upgrading to a mansion. We're out of here. That's the meal. I tried to kind of recap it, all the courses for you from Romans 8, into one super tasty. I mean, this is one, it's worth revisiting. And for your soul, I just want to encourage you, if you don't mind, I know some of you won't write it out and put it on your fridge, but you can use your printer, or you can find a little. I've seen you guys, you're pros with your phone, like, my wife says, I rule the world from my phone now, you know. Answers the kids' text and does all the things and prints and helps them do their homework and all from the little iPhone, you know. Print up the last two verses of Romans 8, the icing. Put it where you'll see it every day this week for me, would you? Your screensaver, she says. Put it on your screensaver and just see if this doesn't help you in your attitude. With that sweet taste on your lips going, nothing, nothing, height, depth, power, principle, nothing, angels, cannot separate me from the love of God. Can anything separate you from his love? Do we need a reminder here, like every day? If I started the day thinking nothing can separate me from the love of God in Christ. Would that help me face the day? Would it help my son-in-law in the field, in the military, to remember nothing will separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus? Man, I wish that all the servicemen would hear that. You know, they say there's no such thing as a atheist in foxholes. You know, when these guys get into the front line fighting, you really consider your life and the afterlife. You know, it's right in your face as a reality. You might not make it through that day. But you need to know, even if you're cut off from this life, the love of God will not stop for you, because he will still love you. And he has something waiting for you. Put your faith in him and his and the finished work of his son. And even though you might leave this earthly body, you will not be away from the love of God. You'll just be upgraded to a new body. And I pray, if you don't mind, share this message. It'll come on the YouTube in the next couple of days when they're done editing it. And you can, I got the privilege last night of, for the first time, my own mother, she's not a technological type person, and her boss bought her a smartphone, and I said, Mom, do you have a way to go on the internet with your phone? I don't do that, son. I just use it to make calls. And I learned how to text now. And I said, do you like ever look up a recipe or anything with it? You know, have you learned that, you know, maybe has anyone showed you, you can like look up recipes and stuff on the internet. She goes, why, your sister showed me how to get this Pinterest. I see it recipes there. I said, good, Mom. I said, I'm on Pinterest now. And she goes, you are? I said, oh, yeah, I got a whole following. My daughter was like, you're not on Pinterest, Dad. I said, yes, I am. The kids are telling me, you got to get out there in the social media. So I have Pinterest and Google Plus and Russian Facebook. I got like 2,600 friends on Russian Facebook. I haven't met one of them, but I have them. And all I do is share the sermons from YouTube to Russian Facebook. And do you know that the most watched sermon in Russia right now is the one that I did a while back on His Promise? And I put little colon, what's in English, the two double dots. Not colon. His Promise, colon, eternal life. That one on eternal life is the most watched video in Russia right now. Former Soviet Union, if you want to be politically correct. I'm being told, though, I heard on our CSN station this week that they're going to try to censor and cut out people's access. We gained 11 Russian subscribers this week to our YouTube channel. I'm like, praise the Lord. I mean, they just listen to the sermons. That's all I have on my wall. All they can do is like it. They gave me like this celebrity status thing, and they can't comment. They can just put a heart. That's their thumbs up. And I'm like, okay, cool. Do it. But this is something that my mom, for the first time, I'm like, Mom, just type, and I didn't even know what to type to get to it. I'm like, hang on, I'm going to share a sermon to Pinterest real quick. Shared it to the little pin board, and I said, oh, there it is. I copied she goes, send me the link. So I linked my mom to the first, she gets to hear Romans, she gets to hear the sermon from last week. And I wanted to see if it worked, so I clicked it while I was there, and it started playing right on Pinterest. And I was like, it was kind of like watching on YouTube, only smaller. I like YouTube's better, you can blow it up, but it is right there, right on the board. So if you don't mind, help me, just go on our, on back of the bulletin, it says amazinggracekona.com, and just click the link. Follow us on Facebook. Follow us on YouTube, and share it to the digital. To maybe you have someone that doesn't go to church, or they can't go to church. What about the guys who are stuck in a nursing home that don't get out? I have a heart that I want to somehow. I mean, I already did all the work, prepared the sermon, did all this setup with the gang. You know, we're gonna have to tear all that. All that stuff is all done. It's in the bank. But I look at it like I get extra interest on that work if you guys just help me share it to somebody who maybe doesn't go to church or doesn't get out. Or maybe they won't. They just need an encouraging word. Maybe you could take the sermon from today and you got someone in mind that could need to hear that food for their soul. And if you wouldn't mind, just share it to them. There's so many different ways you can do it. Now, I'm not going to tell you how, but if you need help finding out, ask a young one. Yeah. They can do it. Like, they'll be like, Grandma, give me that. Did you share it to 15 things for you? There you go. Like, in 10 seconds or less. I mean, they're so quick. Done. But no, seriously, if you would help me, let's get the gospel out. Why not? We're just a little fellowship, but can we make an impact in this world? Can we help others get their soul fed? Sure. And that's what I'm asking you to do with me. Just help me to get the word out. And I'm so blessed. Our little devotionals, words of encouragement, we film with the kids, questions they have. What about when I feel lonely? What about when I feel depressed or suicidal? Or those little, they're like 3 to 5 minutes. Like I take the verse that answers that question and I highlight it. And those particular things are getting thousands of views, tens of thousands, some of them. The depression one jumped like 7,000 views over the holidays. Do people get depressed in our country at holidays? I mean, the suicide one jumped like crazy. It tells me we beat Oprah out on the, you know, when the you type in words of encouragement, it's always Joyce Myers, someone named Jameer, sometimes Anthony Robbins, then Oprah. She's always got like number 3 or 4 slot, and then us. In the last couple weeks, we've been bumping Oprah down. And I'm just like, oh, good, you know. That's because some of you have been watching the thing. And their little algorithm goes by how many times does it get seen and how does it get shared. And so if you don't mind, just click in words of encouragement. And when you see the little videos of us, you'll recognize us on the thumbnail. And just share it or watch it. Put the thumbs up on it, please. And that gives... It's so weird the way their algorithm works. When someone else is looking at something else, we'll be the one showing up on suggested videos on the side. And that's helps get the gospel out. So I used to resist it. I'm going to be honest. I'm just good at teaching, and I'll just stick to it. And now I'm like, forget it. I got to reach this next generation, and the only way to do it is play the game. You know, I'm a fisher of men, and if I have to throw chum in that water... Give me the bait, I'm cutting it, you know. I don't care. I'll cut up my sermons into little teeny pieces, and I will make chum. And let's chum for this next generation. Let's get them. Okay? And you guys can help me. Honestly, if you some of you are very computer savvy, just put the playlist on for me on Romans. Let it play through the whole night. I don't care if you're watching or not. Just let it play, because Google doesn't know. YouTube doesn't know if you're sitting there. But their algorithm thinks you're there. And then all of a sudden, we pop up above Oprah because somebody let it run. So if you don't mind, just go home, turn on one of the sermons from our thing and let it run. It makes us pop up higher. And that gives more chance that the next generation. Because do you think they will look into the second, third pages on a Google search? They say statistically, if you're not in that top group, and I mean, not even the top 10. They used to say, try to get on the first page. Now they're saying get to the top of the first page. You got to get in that chunk, right? That's right in the visual window just at the top. 4 or 5 slots is basically what most window finders show. Help me get there. You go, I'm not a preacher. I can't preach. Can you click on your little device for me? Can you go to Pinterest and type in words of encouragement, you know, and find the boards and I put ones down for communion, encouraging pins for, you know, different things for your faith. And I made a bunch of little bulletin boards, pinned the sermons all over them, and now they're getting watched. So those of you that do those social medias, help me out. Let's chum for this next generation. And I will try to make, I haven't figured out a good title. Jan says just call it 1 verse, 1 point, 1 minute, or something like that, you know. Just What is it? One verse, one thought, 1 minute. You know, and just give, just like, because that's where their attention is. You can fight it or you can give it to them short and sweet.
Okay, blessing in a minute.
Blessing in a minute. We got to do that. So help. Just keep that in your prayers if you don't mind. It's going to take more work. It's going to take more guys behind the scenes. But there's been some cool fruit from this so far. And I think we're just beginning to see it. that we're getting, you know, 11 Russian subscribers in 2 weeks on YouTube. That just makes me go, we went up 15, but 11 of the 15 were Russian. I know, because I can't pronounce her name for anything. I mean, there's letters I don't even know on the screen that their alphabet has. You know, I don't even know how to pronounce it, but we got them. So praise the Lord. Let's pray. God, I thank you so much for the privilege to have this as a meal to share with the folks here and the ones that will listen later. And I ask, Lord, as we go from here, this would not be a meal we just taste once and forget. It'll be a meal that we'll come back to again and again to strengthen our soul. There's nothing that can separate us from the love of your Son, from your love in what he did. And so for that, I am so grateful, Lord. I say thank you, God, for your love. Help us to walk in that love as we go from here, in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.